like to begin with extending Eid Mubarak to all of you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you on this blessed day, on the of Eidul Adhaa. Before I come to the main theme of my khutbah, I would like to begin with a very brief explanation about the name of this celebration. These days in the social media, you will see they say Eidul Adhaa, the celebration of sacrifice, which is the proper name for it. But sometimes these days they also say Eidul Hajj. This is where you have to realize, you know, this is actually based on a bid'ah, because one of the major organizations of the Muslims in North America, ISNA, it's not a secret, that's why I'm talking about publicly. They, a few years ago, decided that every month of the Islamic calendar, we will look at the issue of moon sighting. But for the month of Zulhijjah, we'll look at what happens in Mecca. You know, so as if the moon is only for 11 months of the year. There is no ayat of Quran about it. There is no hadith on this issue. It is just their own arbitrary decision. And this is where we have to realize, sometimes we get carried on with this, you know, oh, majority is doing this. Oh, Mecca, Hajj is there, and this is Eidul Hajj. This is not Eidul Hajj. This is Eidul Adhaa. And every Muslim community around the world will look at the moon sighting of their own region and area and decide on that. You know, now you have fast communication. What about 100 years ago? Did people in India, for example, or even Iran knew when, for example, you know, Hajj is going to be in Mecca? You look at the issue of moon sighting in Saudi Arabia, it's a local issue, but then you go around the Muslim world, it is based on the Ahilla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I have appointed the moon as the basis of calculation of the months. Salawat paran hikbar. But let me now go back to this issue of the name, Eidul Adhaa, the celebration of sacrifice. There is a difference between Eidul Fitr and Eidul Adhaa. Eidul Fitr was actually a celebration of our own success in overcoming the challenges when we fast during the month of Ramadan. So on that day, we celebrate our own success. Whereas Eidul Adhaa is actually celebration of the success of Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, where he was able to overcome the obstacles in the way of submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as far as the sacrifice for his son is concerned. And this, you know, celebration of Eidul Adhaa in remembrance of what Ibrahim had done is very well connected with us. We actually look at our own faith. We say this is Deen Ibrahimi. We are continuing this teachings, the fundamental teachings of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And interestingly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described Ibrahim alayhi salam as Hanifan Musliman. You know, this is in Surah Ali Imran, ayah 67. Even before Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكِنْ كَانَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا. He was not a Yahud or a Nasara. They didn't even exist at that time. Allah says he was a sincere Muslim. So our name is actually the name of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Not only that, there is another ayat where we are told that, you know, long before Islam, he is the one who was سَمَّاكُمْ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِ. Ibrahim is the one who has given this name to us when he prayed, when he was building the Kaaba. This is where he said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, about blessing him with the descendants through Ismail. He says, oh Allah, raise among them a community who will be al-Muslimin. وَهُوَ سَمَّاكُمْ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. He is the one who named you as Muslims. And this name, Islam and Muslim, is very much tied with this celebration of Eidul Adhaa. Because we need to really refocus in our name, our identity, as followers of Islam, as Muslims, because we are at the moment under pressure, intellectually, socially. There is a lot of pressure out there for us to abandon the essence of our faith, and which is servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ubudiyya, to become the abd and the servant and the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are being told that, well, you can follow whatever you want. And this is where we come to realize, I recited the majlis last night, I emphasized the point that during these days, our struggle is not about Islam versus other faiths. The challenge that we have is actually the servitude to Allah versus the servitude to our own desires. It is Allah and our desires which have become, in a way, against one another there. It's not another deen which is coming in. And an ayat which I recited last night, but I didn't go through the entire passage there. I would like to share it with you. In Surah number 25, ayat 43-44, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this phenomenon, where there will be people who will become slaves of their own desires, as opposed to being slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he addresses the Prophet and he says, أَرَعَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهُ هَوَاهُ? O Muhammad, have you seen or do you know of somebody who has taken his desires as his God? So it's not other religions we are talking about. We are talking about our own desires becoming in place of God. And then Allah says to him, أَفَعَنْتَ تَكُونُ عَلَيْهِ وَكِيلًا? Will you become the wakil for him? Speak on his behalf? No. And then the ayat goes on, the next ayat, أَمْ تَحْسُبُ أَنَّ أَكْثَرُهُمْ يَسْمَعُونَ أَوْ يَعْقِلُونَ? O Muhammad, these people who follow their own desires, where their religion has become following whatever they want, do you think that most of them hear and understand? إِنْهُمْ إِلَّا كَالْعَنْعَامِ, they are nothing but like cattle, cow and sheep. Rather, بَلْهُمْ أَضَلُّ سَبِيلًا, they are even worse. Human beings have been given the power of intelligence. Animals have not. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very clear about it. Another ayat on the same theme where he says again the same words, أَفَرَعَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهُ هَوَىٰ وَعَضَلَّ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ? The consequences of becoming the servant and the slave of our own desires are very serious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't take this issue slightly and lightly. He actually says that these are the people, if it happens, if they become the servants of their own desires, even after the guidance which I have given to them, خَطَمَ عَلَىٰ سَمِعِهِ وَقَلْبِهِ, he will abandon that person, put a seal on his ears and his heart. وَجَعَلَ عَلَىٰ, and this is where we come to realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes this issue very seriously. And so this is where I believe it's very important to, reflect on this concept of Eidul Adha, to sacrifice, and this is remembering the sacrifice of Ibrahim alayhi salam, to overcome our own desires against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because this, idea has been promoted, and we are pressurized on different levels. You look at the education system in the schools, in the media, at the workplace. The definition of marriage has already changed. This issue of gender identity is no more, defined properly. Everybody can decide whatever they want to be. This whole business, in the business where you are told by the HR, write he or she or this and that, you start thinking, who is this? Is it or something else? You know, and you remember these ayat of Quran, that they are like an'am or even adal. They're confused. They don't know, you know, what they are. And this is where it is, I would, you know, urge you to take this celebration of Eidul Adhaa as a point of reflection, time for reflection on this challenge. Protect ourselves and protect our family and children from this deviation. The surah that we recite in Namaz-e-Eid, you know, it has one ayat there where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بَلْ تُؤْفِرُونَ لَحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَلَآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى. That people, you know, sacrifice or prefer the worldly life, whereas the hereafter is better and everlasting. إِنَّ هَذَا لَفِي الصُّحُفِ الْأُولَى. This is not a new message of Islam. This has been in the books which have been sent before. صُحُف إبراهيم وموسى. Even in the books of Ibrahim and Musa. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to follow the footsteps of Ibrahim in overcoming our desires and submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فأحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الواحد الصمد الذي لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وعنا عليا أمير المؤمنين وذريته المعصومين أئمتنا صلوات الله عليه وسلم. So Eidul Adhaa basically is the celebration of sacrifice. You know, normally we see the pictures also, people send these electronic Eid greeting card for Eidul Adhaa, and you have the poor sheep or the goat there. And we relate Eidul Adhaa, we also in Urdu and Farsi also we say Eid Qurban. The meaning is proper, there is no issue. And yes, Hujjaj, the pilgrims on that day, it's wajib for them to make a sacrifice in remembrance of Ibrahim alayhi salam in Mina. And for the rest of the Muslims, it is recommended. There's a perception out there that you must have a Qurbani wherever you are. No, it's wajib for Hujjaj. But for the rest of the Muslims, it is recommended, you know, so you can share one third for the poor, one third for the mu'mineen, one third for the family. This is done on a ritualistic level, but I think, you know, we have to move to a higher level. This is Eid Qurban, Eidul Adhaa, you know, celebration of the sacrifice. But it's actually the sacrifice of our desires. Instead of putting that goat and, you know, sheep there, we actually have to do this spiritual qurbani of basically suppressing our desires, our likes and dislikes, and prefer the legislative will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason I'm putting these words, legislative will, because if Allah wills, you know, you can't do anything. But we are talking about His legislative will, that He says, I will not force you, but this is halal, this is haram. I would like you to submit by your own will here. And so this is where we had to look at this issue of preferring Allah's will against our own desires, whether it's in our personal life, what we like, we don't like, or in our family life, lot of challenges. You know, we sometimes give in. We're talking about peer pressure. You know, family pressure is also one of the challenges. And remember at that time, you know, the sacrifice of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Social life, you know, the what we call peer pressure. You know, this is something we have to really think about it. Our imams have said that be selective in choosing your friends so that their influence is a positive influence on you as far as Islam is concerned. Not those who are going to pull you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we talk about the community life, the same thing. You know, business life, Allah has guaranteed in Surah Talaq, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهِ, in the pursuit of your livelihood, if you exercise righteousness and fear displeasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, He will find ways for you. Maybe this is a deal which is very good for you, or a job which is very good, but from the Shari'i Islamic point of view, it's haram. If you leave it on the side, if you abandon that for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has guaranteed that He's going to open other doors for you. And you think about it, reflect about it in your own life, and inshallah you'll see that His promise has been there. Even when we talk about, you know, socio-political activities, always we have to keep our faith and our values in our minds. And it's only then we can become the followers of Ibrahim as a Hanifan Muslima, as a sincere Muslim. Salawat upon Nabi Barah. But this process is not easy. For me, it's very easy to stand here and say, you know, for myself and for you, but we really have to deal with the shaitan within and the shaitan without. The shaitan out there can only influence us if we give access to him. And this is where we have to deal with our own hawa and nafsani, as we call it, our own desires. And we have to do it every day. You know, look at the ritual of Hajj. When we talk about the sacrifice of Ibrahim alayhi salam, we don't go from Arafat to Mina and then do the Qurbani first. On the day of Mina, Eidul Adhaa, what do we do first? First, we go for stoning the symbol of shaitan. It means first you have to deal with this shaitan within and without. Once we got rid of that, then you go and do the Qurbani. Just as Ibrahim alayhi salam, you know, shaitan came at three points. These pillars that you see, which Saudis have expanded it, you know, overweight pillars of symbols of shaitan now. Three places he comes and he says, you know, he talks to Ibrahim in a very positive, sympathetic tone. He says, Ibrahim, Allah, you know, He's great. He doesn't want you to sacrifice your son. This is just your dream. You know, and it's basically Ibrahim in a way stoned him. And he comes again and he says, Ibrahim, nations will follow you. If you do this, they will start slaughtering their own sons. This is not a good thing. You know, so shaitan doesn't come as shaitan. He doesn't say, you know, I'm going to misguide you. You know, use all these intellectual arguments, the way he even talked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he says, why should I do sajda to Adam? You created him from clay, you created me from fire. You know, rationally thinking, his argument was right. He said, I'm superior to him. What if he forgot that the creator of Adam and Shaitan was the same, and he's the one ordering you to do sajda? And so we have to be careful about it, that when we talk about this struggle to submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, we have to every day deal with this issue of, you know, confronting the shaitan, in a way symbolically stoning the shaitan. And it's not only done once, Even the rituals in Hajj, although Ibrahim only was confronted by Shaitan three times, and that's why you heard the three pillars. But we are told that you'd stone that on one day, the second day, and then third day. And not only once, every time you had to stone, seven pebbles. You know, and so the symbolic message that we are getting is that this is a more, you know, involved process before even we reach to the point of sacrificing our own likes and dislikes and preferring the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat pranik parah. For us, the issue of sacrifice is nothing new. One of the hallmarks of Shia Islam is sacrifice. Karbala is the peak of that. And the way Allah has asked us to remember the sacrifice of Ibrahim, which really didn't happen. He fulfilled the dream, but then Allah, you know, sent the lamb from Jannah, not from Australia and New Zealand, the way Hajjis do that. But, you know, this was for Jannah, and Ibrahim alayhi salam sacrificed that. And so there was not real sacrifice in that sense, it was more symbolic. But you look at Karbala. You know, I don't want to recite Masaib on the day of Eid, but I'll just, you know, give you one comparison. Quran says that when Ibrahim alayhi salam talked to his son, teenager, you know, I have seen this dream more than once that I'm sacrificing you. What do you think about it? A point of reflection for the parents. When your children reach to the age of teenager, you don't impose things. Talk to them. Try to convince them according to your own, you know, proper thinking. So Ibrahim doesn't say, oh, you have to do this. He says, think about it. Ibrahim is a Nabi. Ismail is also a Nabi. And what does he say? He says, Ya Abata, the ayat of Quran. You know, do what you have been commanded. Satajidani inshallah min as-sabirin. Inshallah, you will find me among those who are sabir and patient in this process of sacrifice. That's in Mina. You move fast forward. The caravan of Hussein is moving towards Karbala. Just as Ibrahim saw a dream, Hussein riding in the front of the caravan has this vision. And somebody is saying that this caravan is moving towards death, and the death is moving towards this caravan. And this is where Hussein, you know, in a way, came out of that state and uttered the words, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. This is Ibrahim of Karbala. His young son was riding just a little bit behind him. When he heard these words, Ali Akbar moves forward. And he says, oh father, what you said is haq and truth. But what was the occasion here? And he talked about this vision. Remember the response of Ismail, satajidani inshallah min as-sabirin. You will find me among those who are sabirin, who are patient in this sacrifice. Look at the response of Ali Akbar. He says, Ya Abata, alasna ala al-haq. O father, are we not on the truth? And Hussein said, definitely. The response of Ali Akbar was, O father, we don't care whether we go towards the death or the death comes to us. And that is why the way we remember the sacrifice of Ibrahim, when we look at the Karbala, the sacrifice there, we also remember it in a more intense manner. And this is where we had to realize that we had to maintain our spirit of sacrifice, learning from Ibrahim and from Hussein ibn Ali. Let me, before I conclude, just those who are in the masjid area, if you look on your sides and even at the back, I don't know if the camera is able to capture this new calligraphy that we have. I was always thinking of, you know, putting in a Shi'i symbol to our masjid. And I saw these four borders on the windows, and we then finally selected this calligraphy where you have the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the top. On one side says La ilaha illallah, and the bottom it says Muhammadun Rasulullah. On the other side it says Aliyun Waliullah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be among the true followers of Islam and the path of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wa salatu wa salam. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidil Mursaleen, Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina Bil Qasim Muhammad wa ala Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullah alayhi وعلى سيدة النساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين زين العابدين ومحمد بن علي الباقر وجعفر بن محمد الصادق وموسى بن جعفر الكاظم وعلي بن موسى الرضا ومحمد بن علي التقي الجواد وعلي بن محمد التقي النقي الهادي والحسن بن علي العسكري صلوات الله عليهم اجمعين اللهم صل على امام زماننا وولينا الحجة بن الحسن القائم بالحق المنتظر المهدي الذي ببقائه بقيت الدنيا والآخرة وبيمنه رزق الوراء اللهم ارزقنا توفيق الطاعة وبعد المعصية وصدق النية وإرفان الحرمة واكرمنا بالهدى والاستقامة على دين محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين بجودك وكرمك يا ذا الجود والكرم إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد